The idea of the death camps is something so incredibly monstrous that we should spend a little bit of time thinking about the intellectual origins of the idea within the context of the Holocaust. And I want to say two things by way of introduction. The first off, we should be aware that there are really two different kinds of camps. Towards the end of the war, the distinction between them was blurred, but in the middle of the war, there's a very clear, bright line that separates the so-called Konzentrationslager, or concentration camps, and the Vernichtungslager, or destruction camps, the literally make into nothing camps. I've translated that as the death camps, because these were camps which were not designed to hold prisoners, to hold, you know, enemies of the state or perceived enemies of the state, antisocial criminals, you know, people belonging to a different political persuasion and so on. These are camps which were designed exclusively or almost exclusively for the purpose of death, in order to take in living beings and squeeze every last resource out of them, whether it be a certain amount of slave labor or simply the natural resources of their hair or their gold teeth or their prostheses or their glasses, and then simply kill them. We'll look in a future video at the actual operation of the camps, but we're going to look now at the origin of the idea. The second thing that's important for us to remember is that the timing of the death camps is very clearly related to Operation Barbarossa. As Barbarossa progressed, we begin to see the idea of the death camp coming to fruition. Some historians have argued that the conception of the death camp really came about because Barbarossa succeeded beyond Hitler's imagination, that he had penetrated the Soviet defenses so easily and was able to murder so many hundreds of thousands of Jews and others with the machine gun fire of the Einsatzgruppen, that he said, as it were, well, what's stopping us from doing this more efficiently? Other arguments are that no, in fact, towards the winter, when we begin to see the death camps really getting into an experimental mode, with the winter and the slowing down of Nazi troops, there began to, you know, kind of like emerge in Hitler's mind the germ of the idea that perhaps they would not survive the war as a whole, and that ultimately their defeat some years down the road was betrayed by the Russian winter. And so Hitler thought, as it were, if I can't win the war against the East, then at least let me win my war against the Jews. So either of those two possibilities has merit, and perhaps a combination of both of them. But let's look now at the idea of the death camps per se. As we mentioned in the second lecture of this series, the intellectual origin of the death camps was the notorious T4 program, named after an address, Tiergartenstrasse, that housed something called the Charitable Foundation for Cure and Institutional Care. And this is such a cynical type of euphemism, typical of the Nazi vocabulary. Really, what this was all about was a Nazi plan to rid the German people of any of their population that had any mental or physical deformities. As you see in this picture here, a propaganda picture from the era, Leben ohne Hoffnung, life without hope. And the Nazis essentially relegated all kinds of people with mental illnesses, with physical disabilities, with Down syndrome, and other types of disabilities as being life without hope, or as they said it in a different context, life unworthy of life. A horrific thing. Even to repeat it, it makes me feel ill. But this plan was to take these people, children and then later adults, and to murder them. The plan ultimately hit a roadblock when there was objections, particularly from the church, when the word began to leak out that this is in fact what they were doing. But nevertheless, the idea of mass murdering a specific population, in this context not necessarily Jews at all, but people with physical or mental disabilities, allowed Hitler to explore the idea of a more mechanized, systemized, bureaucratized murder. And they used gas first carbon monoxide as their weapon of choice. Here's another example that shows the way the Nazis thought of human beings in a transactional manner. This is a propaganda poster that describes a mentally ill person and how much it would cost to maintain his life in Germany. As if to say that these people who have life without hope, these people who are going through a life that is unworthy of life, look how much it costs society. We should not be paying this amount of money. They are not worth that amount of money. We begin to see the idea of the T4 methodology applied to Jews in two major areas. The first is an important conference that took place at a Berlin resort called Wannsee in this building, where Hitler's top officials gathered together a circle of men to decide how to put in place the so-called Endlösung, or the final solution. They were working with some experiments that I'll discuss in a moment as data for their plans, but this is actually the first clear and unequivocal indication that the Nazis planned to massacre all the Jews of Europe. Importantly, at this conference was Adolf Eichmann, shown here, and who was in many ways the architect of the actual mechanism of the Holocaust, the death camps in particular. And at this conference in January of 1942, he kept very meticulous notes that were later typed up. And as you can see here, this is one of the most chilling documents of the Holocaust. It's just a column of numbers, but what it represents is the estimate of the number of Jews that would have to be killed in order to achieve the goals of the Endlösung. And just the fact that the Nazis went about this with this kind of, you know, bureaucratic and thorough and detailed, everything lined up, all the decimal points in a row, it's a terrifying look into what the Holocaust was really about. Here you can see the regions that were within the Nazi military framework. You can see the General Gouvernement prominently noted there with 2.2 million Jews. But also in this section, many countries that were not directly under Nazi control, or in fact not even under Nazi control at all. You can see England near the top of the list with 330,000 Jews. And look down the list a little bit, about eight numbers, you have tiny Albania, that the Nazis were actually going to hunt down 200 Jews in tiny Albania in order to fulfill their quota of the Endlösung. An absolutely chilling document that indicates the lengths to which the Nazis would go in order to fulfill their objectives. As I mentioned, the people who got together at Wannsee were not operating in a vacuum. They had been conducting experiments primarily in the use of gas vans to kill people, first under the T4 program, and then increasingly groups of Jews from the smaller ghettos in Eastern Europe, where they would essentially pile Jews into a van and close the back doors and reroute the exhaust into the cabin of the van and then simply run it for several miles until finally the Jews would die of asphyxiation. So they began to think about using gas as a more mechanized and efficient way of killing large numbers of Jews. One of the first places where they put this into effect is in a small village in Poland called Chelmno. And Chelmno began its operation in December of 1941. By the time the Nazi Endlösung was under full sway, there would be six similar camps that were all active with the same type of idea and technology. Basically, they would be deporting Jews to Chelmno, unlike the Einsatzgruppen where the murderers came to the local populations. Here they would be taking the Jews who were largely collected in ghettos and deporting them to another site to process them more efficiently and ultimately to murder them. Here's a terrifying photograph I found on the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum website showing a young child being separated from his family, and the family is saying goodbye to him, most likely never to see him again. And they would meet their end, not at this time in gas vans, but in the first stationary location for these gas chambers. We'll speak more about this in the next video when we look at the actual mechanism of death in the death camps. Thank you very much for watching.